From Screen Junkies Studios in the heart of Los Angeles, this is Screen Junkies Movie Fights. Now your host, Andy Signore.
Hello again, Screen Junkies. I've been gone 2 weeks. I'm so happy to be back. This is a fantastic episode. We have some amazing fights, including Best James Bond. Pitch us a Wes Anderson horror movie. I know that's going to be very exciting. Best heist movie and so much fun stuff. So stay tuned. As always, if you don't like what we're talking about, you can pick your fight in the bottom right-hand corner. Skip ahead to what you want to see next. If you're listening mobile anywhere else, we'll have the time codes below. You can find out where the next zone is. But stick around. I think we're going to have a fun one. As always, we're on iTunes. Check us out on our RSS feed. There are two. Go to the recent one. That's people get confused, but I think look for the recent one and you'll have no trouble. Where are the episodes of the last year? Probably on the recent one, so go check out for the newer one. I want to thank, specifically before I introduce these guests, I got to thank Mr. Dan Merle, and I got to thank Alicia Malone for stepping in. I've been on a top secret assignment that all of us as Screen Junkies know what's happening, and we're so excited. And next week, all will be revealed. Wow. I can officially finally announce what we've been working on. Next episode of Movie Fights, so stay tuned. It's literally, I think, Dan, back me up, probably the biggest news ever to hit Screen Junkies ever.
By far the biggest.
By far.
News. By far.
People are like, oh, The Rock's coming on Movie Fights. That would be pretty big.
That would be amazing.
But this is way bigger.
way bigger.
Wow.
Way bigger, guys. So I'm hyping it.
Whoa.
All right, guys. I'm going to introduce...
It was like Coco the Gorilla doing sign language.
I'm glad we could be the last show before the excitement hits.
It'll
you know?
All make sense.
I'm glad you got us in the studio before the cool stuff
happens. It only gets better.
I hype it.
I hope it's a remake of Congo with that.
But let's introduce our amazing guest. Next, first up, you know him. He's a screenwriter and comic book writer of so many fantastic things. It's Mark Andraco.
Hello, everybody.
Mark, I love you because in your first episode, you sort of were the heel, and then you got you didn't, and they loved you, so I want to see what you bring to today.
I got to say, I have been recognized more from this and Screen Junkies than anything else in the world. I've taken about 2 dozen pictures in the last 3 months with people saying, you're on Movie Fights, can I get a picture with you?
So they're nice, so they like you.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Good, because I like you. I want them to like you.
There's lots of people that like Man of Steel out there.
It's true. You are the one. next to him, making his debut on the show, actor and co-host of Guilty Movie Pleasures, it's Ben Begley.
Yeah. You got it.
Welcome,
hey, everybody.
Ben.
Thanks for having me. I'm very
excited to have you
here.
Yeah. You're a big movie fan, so I'm excited. You're going to bring it today?
I plan on bringing it. I plan on bringing the thunder.
Who are you most worried about here?
I was worried about Ellis until he came with this wig on, and now
Wait, is that a wig? Shh.
Oh, sorry. Until he grew his hair and dyed it this way, and now I'm not.
I haven't seen me in a while.
It's just, you know. It's not as threatening anymore.
Well, let's introduce our next panelist. Straight from Gem and the Holograms, is it? No. Oh.
This is not a hologram. This is live, baby. This
louder,
is happening.
The louder half of the schmoes know. It's Mark Ellis.
That's right. Thank you very much. I'm not sure. This isn't like an actual costume. This is like I don't have a goal with this. It's like a Floridian Han Solo is what I was kind of going for here.
For those listening on iTunes, he's wearing a very bright blonde wig, sunglasses, and it's a very nice looking outfit.
The old Panama City second
with no
date.
Sleeves.
Hi, ladies.
No sleeves. Well, thank you for dressing up. Halloween hasn't come for us yet, but it'll have come to you since this airs on Sunday. But we're having some Halloween flavor. I love
it. Come on,
check out
my
scary minion shirt. That's pretty cool. Ripped Apparel. Thank you, Ripped. All right, let's get to this, shall we? Everyone
sure.
knows how the show works. Basing on your score, based on facts, passion, creativity. Any questions before we get started?
No.
All right, cue the montage, please.
Now let's do this!
This is where we fight!
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 Fight! Fight!
Before we start, I do have to cut to him, but I forgot to introduce our special guest next to him. Dan Merle on the fact-checking Dan Cam. How was it hosting 2 weeks ago? That was pretty exciting.
That was fun. I enjoy hosting, but you're right. It's very tough.
But you're not just saying that. It was
no, it's legitimately
tough.
Difficult. And, you know, I get to fight last week, which is fun. I also think it's debatable that Mark is the louder schmo. Christian.
It is. You're right.
It's debatable.
That's fair.
We will both yell to become the louder schmo.
We'll find out in a future episode. But next to you, Dan, I have to introduce it. I'm sorry. I almost skipped this, and that would have been terrible of me. But on the fan cam, we have a massive fan, Meredith Loftus.
Yes.
And thank you for coming. You're a big fan. You reached out. You were in town, and the fans reach out to us. Maybe it'll work out. We have a seat there on the couch. Why waste it? We want to have fans come and partake.
Exactly. And I'm just geeked to be here. So this is going to be a lot of fun.
Thank you for coming. I may check in with you and see how things are going, but please pay attention because we may need your help. And let's do this. We're in round one. Spectre.
Yeah, there you go.
Spectre opens this weekend. and could very well be the last time Daniel Craig plays James Bond. So we thought we'd finally ask this question: who should be the next James Bond? And we're gonna. This came from Jonah Fluitt, Y Bapples, on Twitter. And we're going to start with you, Mark, Andrako. I might call you Andrako. I might call you Ellis, so I apologize.
Sounds fair. I'll also go by the name Vince Neil.
Okay, okay.
I thought Ellis. You were more Bonnie Tyler myself.
Ooh.
Gem,
total eclipse
gem,
of
gem.
The heart.
Go ahead, Mark, Andrako.
I think Tom Hardy would be a great James Bond. I think he's a nice mix of very masculine, very aggressive guy, but he's also got a sense of humor. And I think it would be the best of both worlds because Daniel Craig's been fantastic, but he's so dour. I just want to give him some antidepressants. All three of the movies he's done so far, he's so tormented. And I think Tom Hardy has a physical presence that we've never really had in James Bond. And Tom Hardy's a fantastic actor, too. I think he could play all that stuff. I think he'd be a great more street James Bond than the sort of boarding school James Bond.
Got it, Tom Hardy. Ben, let's hear your take.
I'm going to go with Idris Elba, and I think that I've been reading up a lot on this, and not to steal from Patton Oswalt, but also I agree with what he said, which is that, and part of what you said, which is that James Bond needs some kind of street behind him, but also a suave kind of debonair with him, and I think that Idris Elba has both. I mean, just look at The Big C. He seduces the hell out of Laura Linney in that show, and he's just... quoting the one, just because I haven't seen Luther. I'm sure Luther would give
that's
more.
The first drop of the big C here on Movie Fights.
Exactly. No, but I think that also James Bond was reinvented to such a different degree with everything Daniel Craig did and the filmmakers behind him that I feel like you have to do something completely different this time around. And the only way to do this, there's not something inherently white about James Bond, and I think it would be a way to shake it up and make it just a completely new reinvention because every single Daniel Craig movie has just gotten progressively more awesome that anybody who has to fill those shoes is going to have a hell of a time. So why not just flip it completely?
Ellis.
Which is why you go younger with James Bond. You cast Taron Egerton, the kid from The Kingsman. He was so good as Eggy. He was a kid. He was a street kid. He was a tough ruffian. And then he learned how to become debonair. He put on the suit of The Kingsman, and he carried the mantle very well from Colin Firth. He's now a Kingsman. I think it's a perfect fit. You can go younger with James Bond. I'm tired of casting people that are like 35, 40, 45. They look like they've been out drinking all night. Get somebody younger in there so he can be Bond for a while as opposed to a few movies.
All right, fight, guys.
We already saw Taron Egerton play a spy. We don't need to see him do it again. If we've seen Kingsman, why? If I was his agent, I'd be like, hell no, we're not going to do James Bond. You've just done this already. You've already got your spy franchise where you're debonair and street. And Idris Elba, I think, is great. I think he'd be fantastic. But I think he might be a little... He's getting up there.
He's getting up there.
So I don't know how many movies... I don't know if I was financing the James Bond movies, if I would get a guy who's probably got two or three in him at most. You know, I think if they go younger. I think Tom Hardy's really vibrant. I think Tom Hardy crosses... a lot of appeal. I think women like him because they think he's hot. Gay guys like him because they think he's hot. We do, and straight guys like him because he's a baller. I mean, you know, if you saw any of his earlier movies, the first movie he
Bronson?
Did? Bronson. If you saw Bronson, it was
great. Don't help him.
Oh wait,
Ben.
No, I helped him. God, you know, I'm being too nice already.
And he's a fantastic actor. He's in a movie coming out now called Legend about the brothers Cray. The movie's not great, but his performance—he plays identical twin
he
brothers.
He plays two dudes in it,
and it's fantastic. And the movie he did last year where he's on his car on the phone in his car for 90
I'm not helping
minutes.
You anymore. I know that
so,
one too.
I just think if you're gonna, I think you need. I agree with you that he'd go younger, but I don't think that Taron Egerton. I think we've seen that. It's a redundant beat, and I think Tom Hardy is. Really good.
Ben, what's your take?
Here's my fear on Tom Hardy. Tom Hardy can either be amazing in Bronson, or he can be super batshit weird, almost Johnny Depping it in things like The Dark Knight Rises, where, you know, we got a Sean Connery Bane, or even Mad Max, which is a near perfect film. There's some weird choices he made in that movie that I've seen it three times now, and I still am like, the grunty weird, like, where he's like a caveman. I just worry that Tom Hardy... if he plays it in a way like his character in Inception, and he plays it kind of more like a normal human being and a spy instead of going just into kind of weird actor technique land that Tom Hardy likes to do.
Sure.
Then I think Tom Hardy could be a good candidate, but I worry that two films in, he's just going to go off the rails and they're going to be like, oh shit, we have him under contract.
But if you notice why he goes, the weird performances are not leading roles. And even Mad Max, arguably, that's a
Furiosa, yes.
You know,
talk closer to the mic.
So Tom Hardy, when he's the lead, plays more traditional. And the James Bond franchise is such a well-oiled machine. They're not going to let him get They're going to let him get enough wiggle room to make him interesting, but they're not going to let him go crazy. He's not going to Johnny Depp white face painting funny teeth.
Okay, you guys are making some very adorable arguments, but here's the problem with and look, Idris Elba I think is great. I believe Black Don't Crack, but he still is getting way too up there in years. Tom Hardy has also played a spy before, Mark, and he played a lot worse of a spy than Eggy did in Kingsman. Tom Hardy was in Love Me, This Means War. I mean, that's arguably Tom Hardy's worst movie where he did play a spy, and Tom Hardy is just kind of the same Daniel Craigisms that you're going to get. Yep. It's more of a rough, rugged kind of James Bond. I want to go back to a smoother, more debonair James Bond, like the original one. That's why Taron Egerton is the right choice.
I just feel like then we're introducing kind of like a more
James Bond Jr.
Yeah, like a Twilight version of it, or like it's more like Johnny Quest or something than James Bond. And James Bond Jr. is totally what that would be, because I get that you could get from a producer standpoint, you could get, you know, 13 or 14 films out of this kid because he's, what, like 25?
But it'd also be fun to watch him grow into the role of James Bond, whereas opposed to these other guys, they've just been James Bond for 20 years.
You just do Kingsman 2. But just keep doing Kingsman 2, 3, 4, and 5, and then you can't do James Bond as well.
The Daniel Craig Bonds have the same problem that the Pierce Brosnan Bonds had, where it's like you just keep having to slowly give us the backstory as to how he became Bond. We're never actually showing us that because you also have to further the movie.
But who cares about the backstory? What is your reply? I mean, I'm just listening to this and just trying to get to the points. Like, you're not responding to that. Why do you want to have two spy franchises going at the same time?
Because Kingsman doesn't have to be a spy franchise. Kingsman is a great one-off movie. You don't have to have a sequel to everything when you have a built-in franchise.
The sequel's filming
like
in 2 weeks.
James Bond is. You don't need to have a sequel to Kingsman, though. You would a sequel to James Bond, it's a built-in thing, and you need a new, younger James Bond.
We don't need Diet Dr. Pepper either, but it exists. The sequel to Kingsman is happening. They're making it. It's going to be a franchise. They bumped two movies of Taron Egerton's off the schedule so he could specifically do Kingsman.
Good. It's more practice for him to be James Bond.
And so let me hear you more on why Idris is not good for you.
I think he's a great second choice. I think it'd be great. I have no issue. You know, I think race is irrelevant with James Bond. I think that, you know, I think that Idris is a little, I think he's 47, 48 years old. These are exhausting and intensive movies. And, you know, Daniel Craig's 44 and is like, oh, God, I'm tired. And, you know, I don't know how many movies you have with Idris Elba. So I think with Tom Hardy, going back, Tom Hardy does play the thug thing. But Tom Hardy, unlike Daniel Craig, has a twinkle in his eye and a sense of humor. I've never seen Daniel Craig and gone, huh, that was funny. There's no lightness to him. He's just so tormented that
Except in Skyfall when he jumps and the train's falling apart and he fixes his cufflink. That was...
Yeah.
Yeah, Daniel Craig got a sense of humor. I've seen those eyes twinkle before. And the thing with Tom Hardy and Idris Elba, they both have very packed schedules as well. It's not like Taron Egerton is the only guy working. He's just the only guy that's actually capable of playing another spy. Tom Hardy's going to be in the desert shooting Mad Max sequels.
Ben, last thought from you.
Idris Elba, it's hard because in my... actual thing, I had Tom Hardy and them tied, so I don't know how to answer this.
You should have taken Taron Egerton. He's the best choice for Bond.
I don't know if I'm allowed to do this, but I kind of agree with you, and I disagree wholeheartedly with you. I just don't think it's the right direction at all for it, and I don't have any...
We can go younger, we can go fresher.
I can't win. I can't win with Idris.
All right, well, Ben sort of just sealed his fate in my eyes and gave Mark the point. So, Mark, you're on the board with
thank
one
you,
point.
Eddie. I appreciate the point. Thank you
Mark
very much.
Mark and Draco.
Thank you, sir. This is like the Democratic debate. You're all so nice to each other. You're Lincoln Chafee.
Mark Andrew
I broke the rules. I broke the rules.
With one. Dan.
Just a quick couple quick things. Tom Hardy's 38. Idris Elba's 43. Taron Egerton, 25. Tom Hardy said this week, or very recently, he said that he'd love to be James Bond, and he thinks he'd smash it out of the park. Idris Elba said he'd also do it. And we had two great taglines for products in that round. He plays two dudes in it, which I think should go on the poster for Legend. And Diet Dr. Pepper. We don't need it, but it exists.
talk to your co-host. They're hearing it. He sounds a little quiet. Make sure Mark's loud. And Draco is loud on the mic. Great, guys. Round two is next.
Oh, sorry. To clarify, which Mark got the point?
And Draco. Sorry, I need to make that clear.
I think Ellis got the point.
He even knew it. He even knew it.
Just conceded my point because it's too good.
And Draco and Ellis, that's what I'm calling you guys now, so everyone at home knows what I'm talking about.
We're going to open a law
round
firm.
Round two. Now, this is a fun one. Nick Mundy, I think, emailed this to us immediately after the news broke, and so I loved it, and so this is the question. Wes Anderson has said that he wants to direct. He's interested in making a horror movie, so let's do it. Pitch us a Wes Anderson horror movie. How would it go? Give us a little bit about it. This is a fun one. And Ben, you're leading us off.
Okay. I think something like Friday the 13th meets Scream with a dash of Moonrise Kingdom would be great, where it's a slasher film, but a whodunit. And they already have the final girl and her boyfriend with Sam and Susie. They have the worried parents. They have the bumbling deputy with Bruce Willis. And they have a slew of super weird people that might be the ones trying to kill off all the Boy Scouts. So instead of the Boy Scouts going missing, they go missing because they know that somebody's going to start killing people off, and they go run to try and figure out who it is instead of going on this little love quest. And then Edward Norton is the kind of overzealous Boy Scout leader where you're thinking maybe he's the one doing it. You got Tilda Swinton as the creepy constable that has, maybe she's cooking him and eating him Hansel and Gretel style. That could be kind of quirky and weird, and it could be served in some kind of perfect pie that has a weird awkward close-up and maybe a little note next to it that labels it in the credits. Then also, of course, whenever there's any kill scene in the movie, has to have a very wide shot that goes into a manual zoom that is really slow in 70s style. And also, I think that the first act, you obviously establish the killer's backstory, and then you go into the sleepy campgrounds and all the quirky characters. And then third act, you can just get all zany and have bobsleds and crazy chase sequences. And then you find out in the end it's Adrian Brody.
Spoiler alert.
He just shows up in the end.
Told us the end of the movie.
He just shows up in the end. And then he gets killed via an arrow that's flying with it practically held by the camera. And then it hits him while he's smoking a cigarette. And he just deadpan falls over. That's it. That's my pitch. What do you guys think?
All right, Ellis,
like
let's
the
hear
entire
yours.
Movie. That's very impressive. Wes Anderson does a lot of things really well. Particularly, he gets a great ensemble cast to have an amazing performances, and he tells a very interesting, unique story with a quirky sense of humor. So I think that's going to work very well in my horror film that he will be making, which is it takes place overseas in Europe at a castle where it's a destination wedding. All these people are coming to this wedding, and it feels a little bit like Clue. It's a little bit of a murder mystery, and then when the minister who's supposed to be marrying the couple shows up dead, hanging. I think that's going to be Bruce Willis's character. He dies in the first act. Everybody has to figure out who did it. And here's the wrinkle, is that this castle is purported to be haunted by evil ghost spirits. So was it another human being that did this? Or was it one of the ghosts? We need to figure it out. We pair off. You have a lot of fun interplay between all the quirky characters that are in Wes Anderson movies. And this is why it's going to be a fun horror movie.
Is there a ghost character that you're casting too?
Yeah, I think the ghost character is going to be played by Bill Murray.
Ghost Bill Murray. That's what I was hoping you'd say.
That's right.
All right.
He busted ghosts before.
I want you both. You didn't give me titles, so think about titles too. And Draco.
Mine is called Government Housing and the Haunted Cul-de-Sac. And it's about a bunch of rich people in Connecticut who don't have jobs. They have inherited wealth. Their ancestors came over in the Mayflower. And their lives are thrown upside down when minority housing is being built on the edge of their cul-de-sac. But what they don't know is that that housing is going to be built on an Indian burial ground. So the two charming children, played by Chloe Grace Moritz and Logan Lerman, find a treasure map in an old Boy's Life magazine. And they have to solve the mystery to exorcise the Indian spirits and the races can get along. So it's a horror movie with an uplifting message. And Rooney Mara, who was so good as a Native American in Pan, will play the ghost of the Indian princess.
All right, guys, which one do you want to see least?
Probably I want to see, even though I know the ending of Bagley's movie already, I think I still would rather see Bagley's movie than Andrako's, but I would rather take my movie because it's the one I'm arguing, and I think the working title...
That's a very good argument.
The working title right now of mine is going to be Spooky Castle, because it's a fun, quirky twist, and I'm writing it down right now. I just wrote down Spooky Castle so I can refer to my notes if I need to later in the argument.
But we gave it a title. Okay, great. And yours was called Government Housing and the
Haunted Cul-de-Sac.
Haunted Cul-de-Sac. Okay. Because I expect posters to be made at some point.
I got it. Midnight at Spooky Castle.
Nope.
Midnight at Spooky Castle. All right. Ben, did you come up with the title yet?
The Fantastic Boy Scout Murderers. I love that it took almost your entire answer to come up with that. The Fantastic Boy Scout Murderers. Not murders.
Murderers.
Implying there's more than one murder. I just think the best part about seeing a Wes Anderson movie is you're trying to figure out who is doing this crime, so you can have a lot of fun with it.
Which is why I think mine would be the best, because it follows the slasher tropes that we all love in 80s and 90s slasher films. It has hints of Friday the 13th and Jason Voorhees and also Scream and kind of a wink at the audience, but it also has the quirky characters of Rushmore, Royal Tenenbaums, Moonrise Kingdom, and that kind of stuff. I think the haunted thing is a little too out there. It's a little too ethereal
Well, here's the thing, is that first of all, this argument has the most uses of the word quirky by all three of us.
Of course.
I feel
it's
like,
the only way we can
I feel like
it.
Either when you're talking about the housing situation in a rich part of Connecticut, or you're talking about Boy Scouts being murdered, it takes away some of the whimsy of a Wes Anderson movie, which is what I want in there. When you combine that with horror, it's going to be a new direction for him. We don't have to do all these extreme measures, which is what you guys are talking about.
I think every kill would be very whimsical. You know, I mean, if somebody gets pushed off of a cliff, they fall in a whimsical fashion.
He's a Boy Scout.
That happened, and you just take all the deaths of all the Wes Anderson movies and you put them in a slasher film. You know?
Someone's head in an antique cake
exactly.
display case.
Exactly.
Mark and Draco, any other final thoughts from you?
Well, I would kind of I want to see this one because I think this one could work. I think this one's my closest competition. Yours just sounds like a really, really long episode of Scooby Doo.
But it's midnight.
Spooky,
it's spooky
midnight
castle.
At Spooky Castle,
spooky
and we would have gotten away with it too.
Scooby Doo is also a franchise. It's been running for the better part of 50 years. So if you call it Scooby-Doo, I'll take that as a compliment.
And Freddie Prinze Jr. needs another screen job, so.
All right, I'm calling it. Wow. Dan, any cleanup that you'd like to add?
Just a tip of the hat to SNL's The Midnight Coterie of Sinister Intruders
yes.
sketch, which is amazing.
Oh, so funny.
Also, treasure map in an old Life magazine is one of the most Wes Anderson phrases I've ever heard, so. Kudos.
I'm going to check it. Meredith, you were excited about this round.
Yes.
Which one most excited you?
As
the fan who would
fan.
Go buy the ticket, which movie ticket would you buy?
And I love Wes Anderson movies, so this is amazing.
You can only pick one. They're all playing at the same time.
They're all playing.
And we're all glaring at you.
I'm not glaring. I'm smiling whimsically like someone wearing a Wes Anderson.
I'm going to say...
Ghost Haunt Government Housing at the Haunted Cul-de-Sac, Boy Scouts...
The Fantastic Boy Scout Murderers,
or Midnight at Spooky Castle.
Midnight at Spooky
you know, I'm going to have to say Midnight at Spooky Castle.
Wow!
It's just more standalone. It's not taking pieces from former Wes Anderson movies.
Because he never does that in his movies.
Hey, did I growl or mumble under my breath when you guys got a point?
You didn't
but
get a point.
But Andrea was
decided.
A solid second for
I like Meredith because I was trying to be objective here, but it's like I had to step back and go, which one would I buy the ticket for? Mm-hmm. And I'm with Meredith. After the three pitches, yours felt a little too much borrowing, and yours felt a little bit more original. I like the clue aspect. I think Wes could pull that off. Ellis gets the point with the assist from Meredith. Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Loftus.
No problem.
Where are you from? Where do you fly in from?
Well, I live here now, but I'm originally from South Carolina.
I'm from North Carolina.
Oh, that's why.
A lot of guys dressed like this back in the Carolinas. Howdy.
Round three. Dirty Grandpa trailer dropped with Zac Efron and Robert De Niro. I think a lot of us never thought we'd see a movie starring those two actors, correct?
I didn't really want one, but okay.
But it's an odd screen pairing, so we thought we'd grab this one from Josie the Mexidorian on Twitter, who asked, what is the strangest on-screen movie pairing? And Ellis, you're up first.
Yeah, look, there's a lot of great ones that you can pick from because you have, oh, this crazy woman and, oh, this crazy guy. How are they going to solve their problems? But the strangest on-screen pairing, and one of the most brilliant ones, as it turns out, was Who Framed Roger Rabbit? Bob Hoskins and Roger Rabbit. It was really the first time you were able to pull off with the new technology that Robert Zemeckis and Steven Spielberg were working on with ILM, is that you could have Bob Hoskins, a real human being, and Roger Rabbit, an animated character, have this crazy adventure together to the point where you ended up going to one of Roger's old stomping grounds, Toontown. So you had a human being and a cartoon interacting together. You can have a lot of craziness with two humans, but nothing gets as silly, as frantic, as strange as Roger Rabbit and Bob Hoskins hanging out together.
Mark and Draco.
This is a movie very few people saw, but after I describe it, you're going to want out and run out and rent it. It's called Shadowboxer. It was by Lee Daniels, who went on to make Precious and Empire, and it is the most batshit crazy movie I've ever seen. The strangest on-screen pairing is Cuba Gooding Jr. and Helen Mirren. They play assassins. She's his stepmother. She's dying of cancer. And they're lovers. It is absolutely insane. Joseph Gordon-Levitt is also in it in the second weirdest screen pairing of all time. He and Monique play a couple. And Monique is the nurse at his gynecology practice who smokes crack in bed. Macy Gray's in it. She should be subtitled. But going back to Cuba Gooding Jr. and Helen Mirren, you have Academy Award winner Helen Mirren. Brilliant actress. One of the best.
And Academy Award winner Cuba Gooding
Jr. Inexplicable Academy Award winner and star,
show me the money.
And star of Boat Trip and Radio, Cuba Gooding Jr.
And Chill Factor.
That's right. That's right. And Snow Dogs.
I'm going to get up in your pants like last year's, up in your ass like last year's underpants. I remember
and
that
Boat Trip, right?
Yeah, I said Boat Trip. Boat Trip's a lovely one. But you have, and you see, and you see Cuba trying to keep up with Helen Mirren, just trying to remember.
Was
his
this
lines.
After his Oscar?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
The Oscar was like 95, yeah. I think.
This movie was awarded an F minus by Entertainment Weekly, which is why I went to see it. And I started laughing at the font in the credits. It is the craziest, you'll feel like you're having a stroke watching this movie, and the love scene between Cuba Gooding Jr. and Helen Mirren as she's dying. And
not romantic?
Well, they're in the woods, and it's like John Borman's Excalibur when they find the Grail. Flowers are falling. He's naked and all oily, and his ass is thrusting into her, and then he shoots her in the head.
Oh, that sounds
spoiler alert. Yeah, I don't know. Apparently, actors will go where the paychecks are because I don't know who in the casting department said, let's put these two together. That's a match that we've all longed to see.
Ben, that's a tough one to follow up.
Great. I went with kind of more an awkward screen pairing, which I feel like Hayden Christensen and Natalie Portman are two of the most awkward and terrible screen pairings of all time. First off, because in episode one, Jake Lloyd is like 8 at the time, and Natalie Portman's a full-grown woman, so... Either Natalie Portman, Queen Amidala, never ages, or she has some kind of weird disease. I don't know what it is. Or she's just like older but doesn't look older, and he's sleeping with the babysitter, basically, which may work for porn but can stay out of my Star Wars movies. And every single time they try and have any kind of romantic interlude where they're running through the fields like Sound of Music and he falls and pretends he's hurt, it's all abysmal and terrible. And it takes everything that was great and romantic and sweeping and epic of the first three and just shits on it and makes it this really terrible, terrible... And if I have to see Hayden Christensen's weird shoulder shake, it looks like he's shimmying... In every scene, whenever he's trying to be romantic with her, he's like, yeah, well, I like you a lot. It may not be as strange as Helen Mirren and Cuba Gooding Jr., but it did shit on all of our childhood dreams, and it's completely awkward and unromantic.
All right, guys, fight it out.
What you guys are describing is two very awkward on-screen pairings. I mean, Hayden Christensen and Natalie Portman, it didn't work out well at all. Helen Mirren and Cuba Gooding Jr., you can almost not call it an on-screen pairing because apparently this movie played on like 3 screens total.
Well, they had sex in the movie, so they were a pair.
And they were also a mom and a stepson or whatever, so it sounds like a ridiculous premise. But again, I mean, to pull off Who Framed Roger Rabbit, which is actually a watchable movie, unlike most of these other two
The question wasn't what is the strangest on-screen pairing in a great classic.
Helen Mirren and Cuba Gooding Jr. are two human beings. They're the same species. Bob Hoskins is not only working with an animal, he's working with an animated animal that wasn't even there when they were filming it. He had to play off of nothing.
See, but then you could get...
Natalie Portman and Hayden Christensen.
That wasn't the first time animation was used with humans. Bedknobs and Broomsticks. There was...
Anchors Away, the Esther Williams and...
Mary Poppins.
But they had an entire movie. There's a couple penguins in Mary Poppins. This is the first time when you had... An animated character and a human character solve crimes together.
But you can't say it's a strange pairing because the book it's based on is about a detective who teams up with a cartoon rabbit. That's not a strange pairing.
You also can't say it's a strange pairing just because technology was so awesome that made it work. It would be a strange pairing if Cuba Gooding Jr. is having sex with Helen Mirren. But with that
and Roger Rabbit.
With that even, that movie just sounds... terrible. Where I would argue is that Star Wars is supposed to be amazing.
Again.
Star Wars has a legacy behind it, and then they just go, hey, let's put these two awkward human beings together. Natalie Portman, who was amazing at 13 and then didn't get good again until like her 30s. There was like this massive patch of her work where it's just like, what the fuck happened here? And am I allowed to swear on here? I never
know. No, but
no, don't.
Whoops. I'm so used to guilty movie
Sorry,
pleasure.
Kids and parents who listen with your kids. I try.
Just kidding. I'm so used to...
I apologize for him,
Wild
Meredith.
Man Cougar, that's why I've been getting dirty looks from Ken in the booth. Anyways, I forgot what my point was.
But the problem with both of your arguments is that you're talking about the strangest pairing in this. You know, Star Wars wasn't a good movie, and it shit on it pooped on our childhoods. And yours is like Roger Rabbit's a great movie. It doesn't say in the question what is the strangest pairing in a good movie. It says what is the strangest on-screen pairing. And I got to say that's a depressing on-screen pairing because they both feel like they're CG. That's brilliant, but that's the concept of the book. Mine is just weird. I would never in a million years think, what can we find for Cuba and Helen to work together?
Final thoughts. Great. And any last thoughts?
It's an odd pairing, but if I walk into a movie theater and I'm looking on screen and I see Helen Mirren and Cuba Gooding Jr., or I see Hayden Christensen and Natalie Portman, I'm like, oh yeah, those are two human beings. If I see Bob Hoskins and a cartoon animated rabbit, that is stranger than seeing two humans hang out together.
No, I think that that's just, I think that's more of a kid's movie. I expect that out of a kid's movie. With Helen Mirren and Cuba Gooding Jr., I expect that because they both won Oscars, and I expect them to do some kind of weird artsy project together. Like,
well, there's no art in this movie.
Like everybody who wins an Oscar then goes on to do something terrible together. That's. I'm just trying not to swear anymore.
Any cleanup there?
No. Richard Roper had
I really
a great...
want to watch. I've heard this movie. I need to see the Shadow
Boxers. I'll let you borrow it.
Richard Roper had a great review of it. He said, "The one thing I'll say about Shadow Boxers is that it's never boring. Of course, I could also say that about stepping on crushed glass."
Wow, we really need
Wait,
to check
Mark,
it out.
Wait, Mark, did you say you let him borrow it? You actually bought this movie?
Oh, yes. I watch it at least once a year.
I think we need to set up a
just
screening.
Just to prove it exists and remind All
right.
myself.
All right. And Draco, I give you props for allowing us of the movie, but I think Ben really closed it for me at the end, where I think they both got you. It's not.
If
it's a
cartoon
movie,
rabbit
and they've been doing
here.
It forever, so yeah. It's just a genre. That's what this book was. But you hit it on the head for me, which was they're both Oscar winners. They've done it. And the thing you said that really sold me was the age difference from one to two really makes that even weirder and stranger of why is she now in love with this boy.
But it's never weird when it's Michael Douglas and Gwyneth Paltrow. It's never weird.
That wasn't who you picked.
No, but the age difference, that's sexist. And
so
age
Ben
difference.
Gets the point and is on the board, even though you cursed.
Sorry, I should have cleared that up before. Can you bleep it?
No, but it's all right. Round four. All right, Tom Cruise announced he's teaming back up with Doug Liman for Luna Park, a heist movie set on the moon, which Woo-hoo. Sounds kind of cool. I liked Edge of Tomorrow. Actually, I didn't like Edge of Tomorrow. I liked Live, Die, Repeat is what they should have called it, right?
Live, Die, Repeat.
That's
repeat.
A way better title.
Take your pick.
Edge of Tomorrow sounds like a Lifetime movie.
Yes. Sophie Meredith, SMary95 on Twitter, asked us, what is the best heist movie? There's so many good ones. And Mark and Draco, you're leading this one.
Die Hard, the original Die Hard. It's a classic. It's a genre creator. Most people don't necessarily instantly think of it as a heist movie, but the whole scheme of Hans Gruber and those guys is so smart. And, it's a movie that has been mimicked. How many times have they said since that movie came out 27 years ago now? It's Die Hard on a blank. It's a classic movie. It's an action film that's almost perfect. It's just a brilliant, brilliant movie. And the heist makes sense. The heist is actually smart. In so many of these movies, the heist is a MacGuffin. They don't when you lay out the heist in your mind, you're like, oh, wait a minute. Well, that doesn't make sense. There's an inherent logic to the heist, and the acting in it is great. I mean, it's one of those movies that, it's hard to believe that Hans Gruber, what's the actor's name? Alan Rickman didn't get an Oscar nomination for that performance. It elevates the form of the crime
movie.
Of a movie villain. I mean, that's an Oscar-worthy performance. When he drops down and has the American accent in front of John Clayton, the entire audience is like, oh, he's so smart. So to make that character so rich and so interesting in what is a throwaway genre is great. And it's a movie that can be watched again and again. It hasn't aged a day.
Ben, best heist movie?
Fast Five. And here's why. Because Fast Five is Ocean's 11 with awesome cars and a multi-ethnic cast. And it also reinvented a series that was stalling out, pun intended, on the fourth one. And then has spawned two amazing sequels. All the best movies have come from that. It has a great setup. It has a lot of humor to it. It has a lot of elaborate, kind of like Italian Job style heist moments to it. Then... usually heist films end with the like, yay, we did the heist, and the most exciting point is when they steal whatever they're going to steal. The most exciting point of the movie is the heist, and then them trying to get away with what they've stolen. And the chase sequence with the safe rolling around the streets, it's insane. It's complete insanity that I've never seen in a heist movie before, where they go that one step further and combine so much action and gunfights and everything I want in an action movie, but also with the heist element, and not the MacGuffin like Ant-Man was, even though I love that movie, the heist was total nonsense.
Why are you pointing at me?
Sorry. Yeah, no, I'm just saying. I was just bringing that up. But anyway, so that's my take on Fast Five.
Mark Ellis.
Those are two great films that I love watching that have heists in them. The heist movie that I'm picking is Inception, because so many times you see a heist movie and they're stealing money, they're stealing whatever, they're stealing information in Inception. They're breaking into other people's dreams and they're extracting things that they need to complete their mission. They go dream to dream to dream. It's such an exciting original concept that I'd never heard of before. You can actually break into dreams and you can steal somebody's thoughts. That is such a cool premise. Heist movies have been done to death with stealing money or paintings or whatever else. Stealing dreams, stealing information, stealing thoughts is a brand new thing that I thought was brilliantly done by Christopher Nolan and the actors.
Fight, guys.
Well, you brought up Fast Five, and you cited that it's like the Italian Job. You shouldn't have brought up a better heist movie when you're defending your own movie.
What?
And I'm talking about the original Italian Job, not the Marky Mark one. And Inception is a heist movie. Yeah, it heisted 2.5 hours of my life. It makes no sense. There's no internal logic. Somebody stole the
coming
plot
from
men
who
that.
Likes Man of Steel.
Yeah,
we're not talking about Man of Steel here.
Don't go out of your way.
Can he recuse himself from this? Somebody else needs to vote.
I'm not saying you're not going to win. Yeah. I'm just saying. I'm sorry.
You're sitting in Inception, thinking I could be home watching Shadowboxer
and,
right now.
Yes, actually, I am. And you cited that there's never been a movie where people go into dreams and steal stuff. I would like to call to your attention a movie called Dreamscape with Dennis Quaid that actually made dreams fun. The dreams in Inception are we're on snowmobiles or we're in a cafe. You can dream anything. We've all had dreams where you're like riding a flying unicorn and fighting Hitler. There was nothing dreamy about that movie. It was like, oh, look, we have this set built and we have this set built. And oh, look, and my biggest dream is I'm wearing a snowsuit. It's just a dreadful, boring, pretentious movie. Amen. Amen. You win.
It's arguably one of the best hotel scenes in movie history, up there with Die Hard in the Nakatomi Plaza. But, I mean, look, you have them floating around, and it's such an original take on something like that, where Die Hard, you're right, was a genre creator. Hans Gruber should have won an Academy Award for that, but it's a heist that's in a great action movie. A heist is part of it, but you don't go into Die Hard thinking, I can't wait to see this heist. You want to see John McClane kill terrorists. You don't want to see heist. Same thing with Fast Five. You don't care about
I hope they can steal those thoughts from those people.
That's the whole point of Inception.
It's that stupid talk.
I love Inception, but that is exactly what I mean, where the payoff of the heist is like, oh, I figured out the thought. And it's like, that's not a cool...
I'm sorry you guys aren't high enough thinkers to acknowledge that you need thought in order to be a functioning human being.
You grab this nebulous thing and
Huckabee in here?
I'm just... But here's the...
No politics.
My biggest problem with your Die Hard argument, and Ellis touched upon, is that... You go to Die Hard because you're following John McClane, this lone hero who's an ordinary man who becomes extraordinary in these circumstances that are brought upon him that he's stuck in. I've watched Die Hard dozens of times, and I don't watch it going, that Hans Gruber and his crazy heist.
You go to Fast and the Furious movies because of cars and girls in tube tops. Fast Five looks like a great heist movie.
I would argue
movie.
That Fast Five is a surprising heist movie because you don't expect it from that series at all, and it comes out of nowhere, and then it makes such a fun ride from beginning to end.
But if your argument is... no one goes to that movie to see it as none of these movies people have gone to say I'm going to a heist movie. So that argument,
I would argue that Fast Five out of these three has the best heist sequence and the best escape from the heist. The whole thing is following John McClane's arc to becoming a hero and him saving his wife and saving everybody.
There's characters in my movie, not just ciphers driving cars.
You guys are doing a great job.
There is the Rock in my film.
You guys are doing a great job of proving my argument for me. Is that you go to see Fast Five or Die Hard because they're great action movies that happen to involve a heist. The entire point of Inception is you're breaking into dreams to steal information, and it leads up to this huge heist where you have to go into a dream and then into another dream on that plane ride home, which is the exciting thing. You were there for 2.5 hours, and you're there on the edge of your seat waiting to see if they can pull off this grand heist. You guys have a heist in your movies. My movie is about little heists that make up a huge heist right at the end.
Yo, Doug, I got a heist in your heist.
Right, yes. Ding, ding, ding.
All right. I think I heard enough. Dan, any cleanup on that one?
I swear that time? I don't think I did.
Welcome back, Andy. Nakatomi Plaza wasn't a hotel. It was an office building.
Right. But there were beds there.
I find it interesting. Yeah, these are interesting heist film choices. Of all of them, only one of them is listed as an actual heist film.
Which one?
Do you want me to say?
No. Tell me after
I'll
make my ruling.
I'll tell you afterwards, yeah.
All right. Based on the arguments, I think they both are right and got you down on Die Hard, because Die Hard wins most arguments, but no one goes into Die Hard thinking it's a heist movie.
No one goes into these other two movies thinking they're heist movies.
I don't disagree. But what I did hear is which movie had the best heist sequence and the best climax.
That wasn't the question.
It was Fast Five. And based on these three arguments, I do think Fast Five was the funnest heist, best heist.
Funnest isn't a word.
Yours is a little, I agree, confusing. It worked. It's good. Amazing movie.
This wasn't best heist sequence. This was best heist movie.
I think they argued that yours is not a heist movie.
It is a heist movie, Mark and Draco.
It is a terrorist action movie.
Mm-hmm. That involves a heist.
And yours is more complicated, and it was a good answer, but I didn't hear enough of why the heist was there, and I just because there's a heist in the heist, doesn't mean we understood it.
Sleep with one eye open tonight, senor.
And that yes. safe scene, which you brought out, is a really...
It's incredible. It's
a, no, it was also what I liked. You said it was a surprise. You didn't go into that franchise seeing that that was what it was, and now that's what those movies have become, yeah. and that's what those movies have become successful becoming as heist movies. So Ben gets another point.
Yeah.
Whew, Dan, what were you going to say?
It's just that, I mean, everybody, Die Hard and Inception are...
Debatable, right?
But Fast Five is the only one that I found.
Thank
in multiple
you.
Places, they're like, this is a heist film.
Thank you.
Go to Amazon.com and type in heist movies and see what they pull up.
Heist by David Mamet will be the first one that comes up.
Seriously.
He's so cool when he sleeps. Sheep count him.
All right, as we know, there are many more Transformer movies coming. And to the dismay of many fans, Akiva Goldsman announced that the humans will still be a central focus in the story. So, hopefully that we can put in some good humans to make up for the fact that the humans are usually the worst part of these movies. Well, there's a lot of things depending on where you come from. But let's debate. D. Connor on Twitter asked, what actor should be in a Transformers movie? And we did make a rule, you can't pick The Rock, because a lot of people just automatically pick The Rock. Oh, The Rock makes everything better. Yeah, I don't know if you would have done that, but no Rock.
I would.
We love The Rock, but he was out. Who else do you put in this? And we're starting with you, Ben.
I said Sylvester Stallone, Sly, because if Stallone can resurrect the careers of Antonio Banderas, Wesley Snipes, Dolph Lundgren, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and even get everybody else in that slew of retirees on the screen again, he can resurrect the Decepticons and the Autobots from the hell that they've been in. I can say hell, I think.
Yes.
If not, I said it twice. And I even have a premise for it. Can I say that?
Yeah.
It's a violent post-apocalyptic future where now the Decepticons have taken over. Look, that's perfect right there. He was in Judge Dredd. He already proved Demolition Man. He can handle his sci-fi post-apocalyptic
action.
What movie
did we take that still from? Is that Rock?
That's his headshot. It's got to be Expendables, right?
Expendables 3. Okay, yeah. Great.
So it's a post-apocalyptic future. The Decepticons have already taken over. The Autobots are in hiding. Optimus Prime has been decommissioned. He's off somewhere. He's at the bottom of the ocean, maybe. They'll just recycle plot lines. Sure, why not? And Sly is the rebel leader of the human race, and he goes around rebooting all of them and getting them to be heroes again, because that's what he does in the Expendables, and he can do that with the Autobots. And I would watch the heck out of that movie.
Okay. Mark Ellis, you're up next.
I am taking the action legend known as Jean-Claude Van Damme to be in the new Transformers movie, because he's more of a versatile actor than people give him credit for. He was a great villain in the Expendables 2, all the way back to Black Eagle.
Wow, I want to see this one too. That's also Expendables?
It was the same photo shoot.
I think that's Universal Soldier, the fourth one.
It was 2-for-1 at Kmart.
It was
photo.
Expendables
but
3
look
again?
At him. He looks like he's looking...
Oh, Universal Soldier, you're right. Okay.
He's looking down the barrel of a bazooka held by one of the Decepticons. Now, he could be an agent for the Decepticons. He could also be helping the Autobots. So he's the most versatile actor you could put in something like this. And plus, it's Transformers. It's big. It's explosions. Is Van Damme the greatest actor of all time? No. Sorry, kids. He's not. But he's a cool action star. He can still do all the karate moves, as he proved again in Expendables 2, or the ninth Universal Soldier movie made. And he's also proven, more so than any of the other actors we're going to hear today, that he can work with robots in something like Cyborg or Universal Soldier. The guy has chops working with robotic kind of thing, so he'd be great in Transformers.
I love that you hire him because his resume has robot movies on it.
How much fun. Look at the other guys we're dealing
with.
I think this is a great call, and he could be the action hero, or he could be the villain.
Okay, I was going to ask you that. Actually, you see him in either way. Are you picking one,
either
or you don't care?
Either way. I don't have a specific movie pitch. I'm going to leave that
you
up
like
to
him
the
either way.
Genius
okay.
That's Michael Bay.
Okay. careful. Mark Andrejko, what's your pick?
My pick is Kim Kardashian. Okay. Because I never want to see another Transformers movie, and I never want to see Kim Kardashian again, so maybe they can cancel each other out.
That looks good, too.
Yeah, I'll take that.
Yeah, but then she opens her mouth, and property values rapidly decline. So, yeah, I with the exception of the third Transformers movie, which was the first 3D one.
The tolerable one, yeah.
The one where they destroy Chicago, yeah. Which I kind of enjoyed, except when people talked. This franchise, I just needs to go away. And if anybody can kill it, it's Kim Kardashian. And she has experience working with robots. Have you seen her husband?
Ouch.
And her family?
Not going to touch that one. All right, guys.
I would argue that that's a hilarious answer, but doesn't really answer the question, because the question isn't how to tank the franchise. The question for me would
be... What actor should be in a Transformers movie?
Which, in my mind, means what actor could save the franchise.
That's your interpretation.
What actor could resurrect it.
That's not the question. Why can't people read the questions?
I think Kim Kardashian, yeah, sure, you could put her in instead of Rosie Huntington or Megan Fox, but I think she would be worse than either of them, which I didn't think was possible until you mentioned her. And then for your answer, I'm forgetting who... Oh, Jean-Claude Van Damme.
Don't ever
never forget Jean-Claude Van Damme. I would argue that you and I are kind of head to head with Stallone and Van Damme, but Stallone is the leading man action hero you need to bring the Autobots back from the grave.
Judge Dredd.
And Jean-Claude
Demolition
Van Damme
man.
Is a little more wooden. Every Michael Bay movie has a sense of humor to it. Every Transformers movie has a little bit. It has a wink, and some of the humor is very racist, but anyways, it attempts to have a sense of humor to it. And I think Stallone, in his action films, he has that kind of wink to the audience, you know, like Cobra. You got an attitude problem, Cobretti? Yeah, but only a little one. I think he'd fit the mold for Michael Bay and elevate it.
I'm just curious. And Draco, who would you pick out of those two, Stallone or Van Damme?
I'd still pick Kim Kardashian because I'd rather see. Well, that means I didn't win. So screw you.
No, I'm not saying that. But let's say you didn't.
If I had to. Oh my God, this is like the reverse Sophie's Choice. Can they just shoot me?
Why am I asking? Because I knew that would be entertaining to watch you have to really make a decision.
Of the two, the least creepy, weird one is Sylvester Stallone.
All right.
And he's actually done good work. Jean-Claude Van Damme wears acid wash jeans today, unironically.
All right. And then what do you say to that, Mark?
But that's why, I mean, Transformers is a franchise that we celebrate and that, like, fans like me want to see be good against. That's why you never throw Kim Kardashian
again,
in
be
there.
Good again.
Yeah, because the 1986 movie was great. The animated film was amazing. So you have a property that can have great films and great content in there. Van Damme is such a cool action star that you can put him in that movie, again, as a good guy or a bad guy. Stallone, you want to talk about Michael Bay doing comedy? Stallone was in Oscar. He was in Stop or My Mom Will Shoot. Not exactly comedy gold right there.
I'm just saying.
And Stallone can only do the good guy. He's tried to be the bad guy before in Spy Kids 4. That didn't work out too well.
Stallone resurrected Van Damme from straight to video hell that he's been in. The Universal Soldier sequels are abysmal. And what has Van Damme done that has been cool other than The Expendables?
But the thing is, Stallone needs to have his name above the marquee, and so Stallone is not going to be able to work well.
Van Damme will do anything for a paycheck.
You want to put the Autobots and the Decepticons on the front. You don't want to have Stallone overshadow what's happening.
Oh, Van Damme would totally overshadow it.
No, Van Damme would just be in there.
So Mark, I haven't disqualified you.
Yes, you have.
I need to see it. Give me one last point that's not something that you want. Why is your answer
the better good?
Because you are giving me a selfish answer, which is I don't want to see the movie, so I'm putting someone bad in. So if you give me a real answer, I will take you seriously.
I have to come up with someone new?
No, but I could make an argument why Kim Kardashian would be good to put in the movie. I'm asking you to do that. Aside from your selfish reason of you don't want to see the movie.
Put her in a tube top and a tight skirt and have her walking in slow motion with explosions.
So she's the sex object.
Sure.
Okay. So you are okay, good. Now you're in this. All right. Dan, anything to clean up?
Jean-Claude Van Damme's name in Expendables 2, and I didn't know this, was Villain.
Villain?
Villain.
The Villain.
So they came up with that.
Both of them should be disqualified for that.
They literally took an L out of Villain, and that's the same.
Making that decision right there.
And you took
and
the
I
check.
Stand by it.
There is a Stallone currently involved in the Transformers franchise. Frank Stallone is the voice of Thunderhoof on Transformers Robots in Disguise.
Nice. It's in the family. Yep. All right.
Oh, God.
I tried to take you seriously, but I don't know. There wasn't much else aside from you wanted to see Kim Kardashian so you don't have to see her. I get what you're saying that, but I think you two brought a little bit more interesting debates to it. So it really did come down between Stallone and Van Damme. And then my problem is you're like, he's the most versatile, Mark Ellis, you're like, Van Damme is the most versatile actor.
No, he's more versatile than Stallone because he can be a good guy or a bad guy.
That's what you said, and I'm just like, what? You didn't give me any evidence.
No, if you rewind, I said
possible.
He's the most versatile actor of anybody that we're going to be talking about, so he's more versatile than Stallone or Kim Kardashian.
Yeah,
that's the only,
well,
only
I didn't hear any reasons
did
why
Did you
that,
see that videotape of Kim Kardashian? She's pretty versatile.
He does splits really well.
Yeah, he can split over robots.
So I'm stuck.
So does Kim Kardashian.
Stallone's not much better, but he is better because he's had actually films we've all seen. And I think the one that ultimately gave Ben the point was that he resurrected Van Damme in Expendables and made him relevant again. Yeah. So therefore, that was ultimately where it went. Stallone and Ben get the point. Ben, you are now crushing these teams.
I was real nervous first round when I totally...
Ben is up with 3 points. The marks are each at a point. You guys got to step this up if you want to make it to the speed round.
No, you got to judge based on what the question is.
You hear that, kids? You want to be successful in life, just swear on a show.
So, I got nervous. I pooped the bed on the Bond question. I warned you guys before the show.
The winner of this question, round six, if it's not Ben, will go into the finals. Ooh. If it is Ben, he's in the lead, and we're going to have to do a tiebreaker. Now we all know what's at stake here. All right, Ridiculous 6 trailer from Adam Sandler dropped, which I know we're all dying to see. Yes?
What is that?
It's Adam Sandler's Western comedy.
Oh, that Netflix thing?
Yes.
Ooh. The Native American Sandler movie, the Native Americans quit.
But the biggest part of the trailer was literally the minute long list last of names. Yes. There's so many. I was like, they put up some names. I'm like, who? Without the first name, I'm like, wait, which one's that again?
Yeah.
It's like Jorge Garcia. Comes up, and I'm like, I don't think
Andy Garcia.
Jorge Garcia from Lost. Not the guy from Lost. Last name only worthy yet.
Andy Garcia. Love him. Gained a lot of weight.
Exactly. I would say Andy Garcia. But anyway, that ending was funny. With literally every actor in the world as Lautner.
Taylor Lautner's in that one, right?
Yes, Lautner. Yeah. But anyway, it brought up the question, what is the best ensemble comedy cast? And we're going to start with you, Mark.
Love it, and I love talking about one of the great comedies of all time, Caddyshack. It's got four very distinct comedic personalities that all come to the golf course, Bushwood Country Club, and play so well off each other. You have Roddy Dangerfield, Bill Murray, Chevy Chase, and Ted Knight, who might be my favorite out of the four. Plus, you have a hilarious gopher that's running amok all over the course, so that can be another character. You have the way that they all interact together and the way that you first meet Chevy Chase and you get to see Ty Webb and how he's a little more buttoned up, but he's got these hilarious one-liners. And you see Bill Murray as the hilarious groundskeeper who's kind of a dunce, but he also has a dream of one day winning the Masters. When Rodney Dangerfield's car pulls up and you have that hilarious car horn, you know you're in for nothing but one-liners the whole time. And then Ted Knight as the befuddled judge just watching all of this madness happen on Bushwood Country Club. It is one of the great comedies of all time, one of the most quotable comedies of all time. And with those four leads, it is one of the greatest ensemble cast, not only in comedy, but in movie history.
Mark Andreyko.
I would go with, and this is, among other things, a comedy, I would go with Back to the Future. Back to the Future is a great, great laugh-out-loud movie. Unlike Caddyshack, which is a great movie, and I know what your movie is as well, and that's also a great movie. This is a movie, Back to the Future, that I just saw at the Back to the Future Day celebration.
We all saw it.
Hasn't aged a day. Is a near-perfect film. It might be the closest thing to being a perfect film out there. And what's great about it is all the jokes were organic and smart without being smug. It doesn't beat you over the head with anything. It's a movie that you can watch. You could take your little boy to watch it, and he would enjoy it, and you would enjoy it, and your parents would enjoy it. And it's funny. It's really hilariously funny, but it doesn't depend on, with the exception of one poop joke, the manure in the car, it never gets base, it never gets dirty, but it's just so smart. And two of the best, I mean, the cast is great. You got Michael J. Fox, you got Thomas Wilson, you got Leah Thompson, you got the late Wendy Jo Sperber, and you got all these great people. And you've got two male performances that, like Alan Rickman and Dyer, two comedy performances in this movie that should have been nominated for Oscars. Crispin Glover and Christopher Lloyd give two of the most amazing performances. They're broad, laugh-out-loud comedy, but at the center of them are real human people. And the comedy, there are lots of laughs in Caddyshack, and there are lots of laughs in your movie, but those movies, I don't think, cross the boundaries of being something you could watch with everyone. And just because you can watch it with everyone, it doesn't sell out. It's funny because it's funny and so well done, and has such great heart, which I think gives comedy. You know, there was the Vacation remake that came out this year.
Mm-hmm, that Helms?
That was so mean-spirited that it made you realize how much heart was in the original Vacation movie with Chevy Chase. And that's what I think makes comedies last a long time. Yes, this is also a sci-fi film. Yes, it's a time travel film. But when this movie, you spend so much time laughing out loud, and for a movie 30 years old to still hold up and not have missed a beat and be that much quality and that laugh out loud funny, I just think there's no other movie.
Two, I think both of these so far hold up. Ben, let's get yours in. What's your pick?
I think if we're talking about ensembles in a comedy, not just best comedy or funniest or our favorite classic comedy, I would go with Wet Hot American Summer for one of the best ensembles in comedic history. It launched the careers of several people, obviously, like Paul Rudd, Amy Poehler, and David Hyde Pierce was, you know, doing Frasier and things like that. Joe Latruglio, Ken Marino. It's just like, it's nonstop. The whole list is just Michael Showalter, Michael Ian Black, Bradley Cooper, Christopher Maloney, who we only know as, like, Salvy McRaperson, you know, who, like, solves all the crimes with molestation and stuff now on SVU. Can I say that? But now, he's hilarious in that. I can't quote any of his stuff because it involves swearing, most of it, except he's going to go fondle his sweaters. It has so many quotable, absurd moments, and yes, it's a cult favorite, so it's not for everybody, but I would argue that the cast is just top to bottom solid, every single person in it.
All right. These are three really good ensemble casts and comedies. I need to hear the arguments as to why yours is the best.
Caddyshack is the funniest movie out of the...
They're all funny movies.
Yeah.
So I'm wiping that out from your arguments. We're not going to argue about which is the funniest movie because that's not going to win. Why is your cast in your movie the best?
Because they're all pure comedic talents. Back to the Future is the most entertaining movie of the 80s, if not of all time. But the funniness that all four of these individual senses of humor bring and the way that they all coalesce into one hilarious movie, because it's very unique sense of humor. Wet Hot American Summer, a lot of those actors are doing the same kind of comedic beats. And with Back to the Future, not all of the ensemble cast is there for comedy. Everybody in Caddyshack shows up to be funny, and they all give some of the best performances of their entire career. You have physical gags, you have sex jokes, you have drug jokes, you have more cerebral stuff that's happening in there. There's so many different elements of Caddyshack that all combine to make it funny. It's not just a one-note comedic movie. You can have your poop joke with the Baby Ruth. You can have Ty Webb hitting on girls. You can have Rodney Dangerfield talking about how old chicks are at a dance. You can have a lightning strike somebody who's not even one of the four I mentioned. The ensemble cast, not just from the four leads, everybody shows up there to be hilarious, particularly the four guys that are legends now.
I agree with what you're saying. I think this is an embarrassment of riches. These are all three great movies. But as far as I would love to know what the cerebral comedy is in Caddyshack. Caddyshack is like a Stripes or something like that, where it's meant to be a comedy, a disposable comedy. I think it's a classic, but it's not up there. It's not as classic as, say, Blazing Saddles. And as far as the performance levels in that, the comedians are in there doing great comedy. But I don't really ever buy any of the characters. I never get really involved in the story and into the stakes. And there's stuff that's
left. The job of a comedic ensemble is to make you laugh.
But yeah,
there's so many more laughs in Caddyshack than there are in Back to the Future. It's a better movie.
There's so many more laughs at a stand-up comedy show than Back to the Future, but that doesn't mean that it's less funny. The thing with Back to the Future is what they're 30 years after this movie made $5 million for one set of showings last 2 weeks ago.
People, but they're not going there for the laughs. They're going there because it's a fun time travel entertaining adventure. They're not going there for yucks. You go to Caddyshack because it's hilarious, laugh out loud.
I would argue there are as many laugh out loud moments in Back to the Future as there are in Caddyshack.
Michael J. Fox hits the guitar at the beginning and he gets blown back. That's a hilarious moment. There's a couple other ones with Crispin Glover and a couple with Biff. But literally every 20 seconds of Caddyshack, you are laughing out loud. It is a legendary comedy.
Ben, do you disagree with that argument?
I think it's a legendary comedy. I think that Back to the Future is one of the best movies of the 80s, but I agree. I don't go to it thinking this is hilarious. I go to it thinking it's a nostalgic, amazing film, a science fiction movie, a great story.
Well, that shouldn't disqualify it because Fast Five won the heist movie thing.
I would also say let's be consistent.
If the rules are the rules, no, it doesn't. Let's have them be the rules.
Back to the Future is a very funny movie, but you don't go there because you're seeing the comedic ensemble. You're going there because it's an entertaining adventure.
I would say the same thing.
That was Fast Five was the only one that was listed as a heist movie. But keep going.
But I would argue that.
But that's not what you said when you judged it.
Die Hard was the one that wasn't.
That's not what you said when you judged it. You weren't allowed to talk about that.
I would argue all your points that you made for Caddyshack can still exist for What Hot American Summer. There's absurdist humor. There's highbrow humor. There's completely. There's repeat callback jokes. It works on so many levels, and it's a movie that gets better every time you watch it, and each person's performance gets better every time you watch it, and all their relationships work on different levels. And I feel like Caddyshack, if you showed, I have a feeling, I don't know because it's a cult classic, but I have a feeling if you showed kids nowadays What Hot American Summer, they'd laugh more than Caddyshack. It's a little dated, and it's a classic comedy, but I just don't think that all the holds up as much as kind of the more new wave absurdism that Wet Hot American Summer
is.
Meredith, which one do you laugh at more? Wet Hot?
Okay, so I'm out.
Two.
I'm out.
Yeah.
Those two.
All
right.
Thanks, everybody.
Mark.
Don't give up. I didn't say that.
You'll get nothing and like it.
Why don't you hop in a DeLorean and pick a funnier movie?
Ouch.
Why don't you pick an argument?
We just made a generational thing, and yeah, Meredith's our youngest person here. I want to ask how
She's never seen Caddyshack.
I have seen Caddyshack.
Okay. And have you seen Wet Hot American Summer?
I have seen Wet Hot American Summer.
There we go. So thanks for assuming she doesn't know her movies,
yeah.
Mark.
No,
jeez.
I'm assuming that young people
don't
watch
them. Feel bad that you walked off.
I take back the sympathy. Okay, I'd have to say Wet Hot American Summer.
Interesting. Okay.
I do love Caddyshack, though. It's a classic for me.
But I would also argue Wet Hot American Summer.
Thank you. That doesn't mean you win.
Wet Hot American Summer is an amazing ensemble. It's a bunch of people getting together to make a very funny movie. But that movie has a lot of famous people in it. That movie launched nobody from that comedic ensemble. They went on to work and do other things. Caddyshack launched the careers of all four of
those
stars.
That's not true at all. Ted Knight had been doing Mary Tyler Moore. Yeah. Rodney Dangerfield had been around forever. Bill Murray
Their
was
movie
hot.
Career. career. You're talking about a TV and stand-up. I'm talking about them being in movies from there on.
What was Ted Knight's movie career
after
Caddyshack?
Ted Knight died not too long afterwards, and Rodney Dangerfield...
He didn't die not too long afterwards. It was about 10 years, because he went on to do the... Too close for comfort.
He went on to do other things because of Caddyshack.
But you said movie career. It's
a movie career. One of them came from TV. One of them came from stand-up. Bill Murray was freshman Saturday Night Live, as was Chevy Chase.
I'm sure Dan is feverishly looking this up.
I just wonder the relevancy of this, though, because I'm arguing the same thing, that it launches a bunch of careers, but does that actually get to the point of which is the best ensemble because of who had careers after? Because if you're really specific, Bill Murray's the only one from that cast that had a really lasting career after that. Rodney Dangerfield's kind of petered out, and Chevy Chase is...
Ladybugs?
Chevy Chase is kind of an embarrassment.
But you can also go the other way, too, is that they're still known for Caddyshack. Is that none of those actors are known primarily for Wet Hot Irish Summer.
I would say you get more... For ensemble, you get more bang for your buck. You get three times the amount of people in Caddyshack. You're arguing four people as your ensemble. I'm arguing upwards of 10 to 12.
It's also hard because there were two more decades that we can base that judgment based on.
But my four... That's a good point. My four get more laughs than your entire comedic ensemble cast.
Okay, just to talk about Ellis's question. Bill Murray did Meatballs before Caddyshack. Mm-hmm. Stripes was the year after Caddyshack. Chevy Chase's next big movie after Caddyshack was Vacation, but that was like 3 years later, so it didn't quite... He did some movies, but they weren't big movies, so I don't know. It made him famous,
and if you watch Caddyshack again...
It's a dubious claim.
I go back to my core argument, is that Caddyshack is the funniest movie out of any of the ones we're talking about by a mile, and the four comedic stars, that ensemble, is the reason why.
Once again, that's not the question. The question is, what is the best ensemble comedy cast?
Yeah, I just answered it. That's the answer.
You're citing four people. That's a cast of like 50 in that movie.
Right.
So I need to hear more from you.
Okay.
Why is yours better than theirs?
Because...
Why is it Wet Hot America for our audio listeners?
I would argue that Wet Hot American Summer is an actual ensemble. I would argue that you'd follow more Chevy Chase or Bill Murray. You follow more people as protagonists in your film, and Michael J. Fox as a protagonist in your film. I would argue that Wet Hot American Summer is actually an ensemble piece. There's not necessarily one lead person you're following. You're following the stories of everybody, and they're all hilarious in their own way. Whereas these are more, you follow two people, maybe four. This, like I said, you're following Michael Showalter's love story, Janine Garofalo's love story, Amy Poehler and Bradley Cooper and their antagonism. Everybody fits into this puzzle equally, which to me is the definition of an ensemble.
But bigger does not necessarily make
I'm not saying
better.
That. I'm saying
and
equal would, screen presence makes it an ensemble.
Are you saying
that these two films don't have that?
I'm saying that Back to the Future is more Michael J. Fox and Christopher Lloyd driven, so that's a
what
duo.
What about Caddyshack?
I would say Caddyshack is more of a duo with some ancillary characters.
It's the definition of an ensemble comedy. Just because your comedy has more people in it doesn't mean that it's a funnier ensemble.
I would say that...
Never seen Mardellis this mad at me, guys.
This is Caddyshack! This is Caddyshack!
I thought I was the reddest one here because I walked outside without sunblock on yesterday.
A lot of that's the wig.
I'm trying to wrap this up, but I'm actually having trouble on it because there's a lot of good thoughts here. Mark, last thought, quickly.
I would say that just because that Michael J. Fox is the de facto lead, Bonnie Raitt's ex-husband, the caddy, is the de facto lead of your movie.
Oh, right, Michael O'Keefe.
Michael O'Keefe. And every single character in Back to the Future is so rich, even if it's Goldie Wilson, the guy who's married, you know tons about those characters. That, I would argue, is yours is more of a jokey movie, which is still funny.
Which is funny, comedic.
This one off of is great, but it feels a little like a sketch. There's times when I think the TV version was a little bit better than the movie because this veered into smugness a couple times that took me out of it. And just based on the fact that it's only 10 years old, 2001 it came out, right?
It's
still, I don't know if it's going to stand the test of time. I think it probably will, but because of its age, I don't know if it's in... Our movies are both 30 years old, so we have a lot of history and to see how the generations have reacted to those movies. This one isn't quite that old, so it's still... Its history is yet to be written.
The TV show did not do that well, correct?
Which TV show?
The Wet Hot American Summer.
It was very critically acclaimed. Of course, Netflix doesn't release viewership numbers.
But they have not renewed it as of today.
Do
we need it?
They
anymore?
Never really said that they were going to do another one, so there's been talk, but there's no official
report. All right, just so he said that, I want to give you 10 seconds. I'll give you 10 seconds. Okay. We're done. Quickly.
I would just argue again, you're arguing which is the more classic comedy. The argument here is the ensemble. And again, it's just that there's more even screen time and more people that you learn about. Like you were saying, the characters, I would say, in Wet Hot American Summer are more rich than in Caddyshack, and there are more of them, and it's more of an ensemble piece, not a Caddyshack protagonist with these goofy guys.
I think more more doesn't mean better. The Caddyshack has stood up to the test of time, and I don't think Wet Hot American Summer, great as a cult classic as it is going to be a legendary comedic ensemble like what you had with those four legends in Caddyshack. Back to the Future is such an entertaining movie. It's one of my favorites of all time, but it is not a comedic ensemble, whereas Caddyshack is.
Oh, crap. All right, Dan, anything you guys...
Do you want me to just buy you some time?
Yeah, well, I mean, I got to make a decision, and it's to be honest, this is a tough one legitimately. I will admit, though, I got it based on something, and I think they are right in that I don't quantify Back to the Future to be a comedy. And so that's where the problem with that of yours is, Mark, so I apologize. So it really does come down between these two, and it really is a generational problem and gap of which one's funnier. So as I'm debating, Dan...
Sure. As Meredith pointed out to me, Christopher Maloney is no longer on Law & Order SVU. Also, his character's name was Elliot Stabler, not Solvy McRaperson.
I think it'd still be on it if it
Thank
was
you for correcting.
Solvy McRaperson.
I went into a little bit of a rabbit hole here with the cast of The Ridiculous Six. My three favorites. Co-host of The Voice, Blake Shelton.
Shelton.
90s rapper Vanilla Ice.
He got Vanilla Ice. He got both.
Yes. Yeah. And ESPN's Dan Patrick as Abraham Lincoln.
I love Dan Patrick. I see an Adam Sandler movie, I'm more excited to see Dan Patrick's cameo than anything else.
He's a funny guy.
Oh, he's great.
He's on Howard Stern all the time.
Great
show. He's fun. He's a fun dude.
Yeah. Can I just say, I'm glad this argument was the last one, because I'm exhausted.
I know, I'm exhausted too. All right. And Mark Andreyko, to his credit, is showing me on his phone that IMDb is labeling Back to the Future as an adventure comedy.
Yeah, it's a funny movie. It's just not as funny. Nowhere near as
funny. I don't dispute that it's not funny, but I just don't think anyone is going, as they said, based on their arguments, they're not going for the laughs of that movie. They're going for the other elements.
But they go to the Fast
and
Furious movies for heist.
So, ensemble comedies, these two would often.
Nobody goes to Die Hard for the heist either. I mean,
Meredith, help me out. What do you think? Quickly, Dan, got any thoughts? I want to be fair on this one, but it's I don't want to.
Judging's hard.
Yeah,
I'm with you.
It's I don't know. I have a way that I would lean based on the arguments, but
mine has
I don't
funny
have a distinctive
too,
favorite.
You know,
here's that Kenny Loggins song that should get
whatever
it right
I pick.
Out.
I'm gonna get yelled at. So my gut. It might be a little bit of a personal opinion. It might be seeping in. It's the only way I can do this.
That never happened.
And this one, I will admit, it might be a little bit. I gotta go Caddyshack.
Woo.
I think it's the more iconic of the two, and I think it's established itself more, and I think that is what ultimately makes the call for me. And you did say that. I try not to let the iconic thing win, but in this case, as that poster behind you says, sometimes it does.
Iconic.
So I'm going with Caddyshack. That puts Mark Ellis in the finals against Ben, Mark, and Draco. I apologize. I'm sure I'll get heat for it. You did great this episode.
Same old.
I gotta say, I'm so glad you came. I had so fun.
Oh, me
too. So much fun listening to you. you are a fantastic player, and I'm grateful for that you came and took it seriously. Thank you.
This will be my last movie fight.
You know what? Out of that Transformers debate, the person most likely to be in a future Transformers movie, definitely Kim Kardashian.
That's because that's the one Michael Bay most likely wants to sleep with.
That's right. True. Right. I don't think she will, though.
Nope.
Let's cue the speed round music, because it's time for the speed round.
Okay.
All right, Ben and Mark Ellis, you're in the finals. Okay. This is intense. We have five questions. This is your chance to win five more points.
Okay.
Ben, you're leading by one. So, Mark, that means you got to get a couple of these.
Okay.
Any questions before we begin? We did practice it before we rolled.
We
all good?
Say it as clearly as we can.
Say it as quickly as you can. You'll have 15 seconds. Question one. Best movie starring Bradley Cooper.
Silver Linings Playbook.
American Sniper.
Silver Linings versus American Sniper. Mark, I heard you first with Silver Linings. Go ahead.
Silver Linings Playbook was a complete comedy drama, and Bradley Cooper was the star of it. It had a great ensemble cast, but Bradley Cooper was clearly the lead, whereas American Sniper, it's a movie about one guy, and it's not really a complete movie. It's more like you're just studying this character, whereas Silver Linings Playbook's a total movie.
So I would argue that American Sniper is the first movie Bradley Cooper broke the mold of his kind of comedic, funny, charming guy, where he had to go deep. I got to see a little bit more of his inner workings and a little bit more what's behind him instead of just this kind of like happy-go-lucky romantic lead.
I would argue that in Silver Linings Playbook is where he developed that. He would not have American Sniper if he didn't get to go deep and dramatic with somebody with bipolar.
5 seconds. Doesn't matter where he developed it. It matters where it came to fruition, which to me is American Sniper. His performance in that is he disappears.
All right, I'm definitely going to activate the panel here. Mark and Draco, based on the arguments, taking all personal judgments from me aside, Which of those two arguments won you over?
Can I defer? Because I hate both of those movies.
Sure, Ken. I'm going to say, I think you got a little muddled in your argument because you said American Hustle was more of a leading role for him.
Silver Linings Playbook.
Or, sorry, yeah. I did have that right. Silver Linings Playbook. Whereas, I mean, American Sniper is definitely the leading role, so I didn't know where you were going. And I think you did clarify that was really the first time he really was able to change his persona, which so I'm giving Sniper the point. Dan, do you agree?
Yes.
Okay.
That was so certain.
You don't have to chime in. So there we go.
So certain.
Oh, all right. Man. So Ben's up with four. LSU with two. You got to get these.
All right. I'll stretch.
Best movie with the word "lost" in the title.
Oh, come on.
They're making sure. Oh, now you got to say something.
Lost World.
Lost in Space.
Oh, wow.
I get the point for this. Raiders of the Lost.
In Translation.
Damn it. Those are all so much better.
Lost Boys.
Mark Ruffalo.
Mark Ruffalo.
Oh, sorry. That's from last week. I'm sorry. I just...
Another one.
Stop tweeting pictures of Mark Ruffalo.
You said
Lost World.
Lost World versus Lost in Space. This will be fun. All right. Go ahead, Lost World.
Lost World is not a great sequel, but I think it's a lot of fun. You get to see a little bit of a T-Rex kind of King Kong running around in the streets. The first half is not that great, but the second half is so much fun watching him smash into buses, and it's just a fun adventure film where T-Rex is lost in the city.
Mark, Lost in Space.
Lost World commits the worst sin of all, where it's a boring movie. Lost in Space is not a great movie, but it's at least a fun adventure. And even though we had a TV show in the 60s, Lost in Space can at least be a fun movie to watch, and it doesn't undo the greatness of what Jurassic Park was. Lost World was so bad, and Jurassic Park 3 were both so bad, they had to go back and make the new Jurassic Park just to undo what Lost World did.
5-second rebuttal, Ben.
I would say it's boring in the beginning, but then, like I said, it pays off in the end, and I can't get enough of T-Rexes. Jurassic Park 3 is terrible, but Lost World was a blast.
Lost in Space has one of the best performances of Matt LeBlanc in his entire career, even better than Ed.
Not true.
Wow, that's sad. I think he got your point. Did he get your point by bringing that up?
Well, there's no context there, so
it is
sure.
The best performance of Matt LeBlanc.
Let's keep going.
No, in episodes.
I want to see the other questions.
Mark has picked.
On Showtime's episodes, it's Matt LeBlanc.
I think
best.
You committed a sin there, Ben, where you called your own movie boring, so I got to go with Mark Ellis as well. Yeah. Dan?
I'm also on
I
Ellis.
Screwed up.
Yeah. So, Ellis, you're on the board.
Also,
literally, he was writing the word Matt LeBlanc, and then you said it just as he wrote it. It was serendipitous. So
okay, can I say, I don't really need to win this anymore because I won an argument where I had to pick Lost in Space.
That was impressive.
Oh, you did it.
I'm amazed.
That's why my face is
so. So, Mark, you have to get both of these.
Okay.
Wait, right? Ellis got the point, right?
Oh, sorry.
So it's 4-3.
I'm wrong.
Ben.
Sorry. I'll get them both anyway.
Thanks. Dan's keeping track. I can't screw it up. All right. These two movies are in the bargain bin. Which one should we buy? Gremlins 2 or Alien 3?
Gremlins 2.
I heard Gremlins 2 from Mark first. Ben's got Aliens 3.
I've never seen Alien 3.
You pretend like you did and don't tell us.
Okay.
Mark, Gremlins 2.
Trust me, Alien 3 is like the Lost World of the Alien franchise. It undoes all the greatness of the first two. Gremlins 2 adds to it, and it adds a really fun, it's kind of like a satire, but it also has, you get to see Gizmo, you get to see a lot of funny Gremlins, so it's the classic mix of horror and action, which is what the first Gremlin was. It's a different tone of film, but it's no less
Time
great.
Up. Ben.
Alien 3, David Fincher, right before he became awesome, and, you know, it has Sigourney Weaver in it again, so that's a winner, and I'm sure there's lots of violence with aliens, and why not? Because I'm a completist, and you can get Gremlins 2 in a combo pack with the first one.
What, is that a good thing or a bad thing, Mark?
Gremlins 2 also has more Gremlins than the first one does, and the special effects are even better than they were in 84. You had more puppetry, more
Alien 3 pairs it back down to what it was in the original one, which is survival horror with one alien instead of a whole bunch of them in Aliens.
Wow, nice little bonus here at the
end.
Yeah,
where was that?
That came out. That was
welcome
a good
to the game.
Dan?
That was good, but it was a little too late for me. I'm going with Mark.
Yeah, I got to say, Mark did sway that one.
Gremlins 2 is great. Go watch Gremlins 2.
I've never seen Alien 3.
Or go watch the Key and Peele skit with Hal Rudnick talking about Gremlins 2. It's very
that's
funny.
That's the one alien movie I haven't seen.
Don't
so we've tied it.
It's a tie game.
It's now a tie game. All right, and we have two left. Ready, guys? Which city would you rather visit? The Emerald City of Wizard of Oz or Cloud City of Empire Strikes
Emerald
Back?
City.
Emerald City.
Okay, Ben got Emerald City, and Mark, you have Cloud City. Ben, you start us. 15 okay. seconds, go.
Emerald City, you get everything. You get the munchkins, which are adorable and so fun. You get the nice witch. You get Glenda the good witch. You get evil witches. You get to fight monkeys that are flying. You get to fulfill every childhood fantasy in bright technicolor. And you get, maybe you might even get to hook up with a hot little Dorothy and have a nice pet together. Toto.
Whoa, boy, did that get creepy. I'm going to Cloud City because Cloud City, unlike Emerald City, is real. Emerald City is a dream. You have to wake up eventually from Emerald City. Cloud City, you can go make a nice life for yourself. Doesn't matter if the Empire is infringing upon that or not. You can get a good government job either way in Cloud City. Leno Calrissian is fair, and he's going to give you a good deal on an apartment.
That sounds so boring and corporate. Everything is in Technicolor in Emerald City. Everything is emerald. Everything is perfect. You can take over the wizard's job. Why not? You can do...
Emerald City is not real, and the wizard gave them nothing that they didn't already have. Emerald City is literally a mirage. You go there and it's like, oh, you already had the heart. Oh, I didn't even come here in the first place.
Mark Andreyko, who are you going to pick on that one?
This was tough because I want to go with Emerald City, but then you made something about hooking up with Dorothy, who's 12 in the book.
Okay, I mean, like in real life, she was so older than 12 when she shot the movie,
but then,
wasn't
but
she?
Then, but then he sold the Cloud City as Emerald City's not real. And
it's
he
true.
Said,
dream. It's
and,
a dream.
And he said,
"All right,
you can get a good government job at Cloud City.
Absolutely.
Why would anyone go to Cloud City? It's Emerald City. A government job is an enticement.
Okay. Hey, not everyone can be like hippie artists like us. Okay,
you want a nice apartment. Hold on, I was swayed by the dream argument. I think that was the stronger. Even though you did get a little weird, the government. You got weirder with like that.
Okay,
with
Christopher Maloney is going to come investigate me now.
So if we're going to eliminate one, I would go with the child sex.
In my defense,
a government job.
When I saw Wizard of Oz, I was like eight.
I'm going with the dream, Dan.
So it's 1-1,
yes,
right?
It's well, on you.
I'm glad I get to break the tie here because as a fact checker, and I'm basing this on the arguments, the Munchkins fighting the Wicked Witch and the monkeys, none of them are in the Emerald City.
Exactly.
So I'm going with Mark Ellis.
Yeah.
Good call. That's right.
That's no down, wow. It's all not in the Emerald City.
Yeah.
All right. Then we're just talking about Oz in general.
They were in the Oz with James Franco.
But
you're right.
For the Wizard
but that
of Oz.
Doesn't...
Mm-hmm. All right.
For the record, for the record listeners.
All right, Ellis, you're in the lead. If he ties you here, we go to a tiebreaker.
Okay. Oh, man.
Which director would you pick? Now, I'm making this clear. You have to make this movie.
Okay.
Which director would you pick to remake Jaws?
Oh, man.
struggle right there.
I would take Colin Trevorrow.
Oh.
The face on Dan Merle right now.
I'm not going to let I'm going to listen to your argument.
Did you not like the Jurassic World?
Shh, you gotta pick. Ben, you're out.
I would take, Joss Whedon.
Alright, this should be interesting. Colin Trevorrow, Jaws, let's hear it, Mark.
Colin Trevorrow has already taken a classic Spielberg property and made a ton of box office and made millions of fans happy with the entertainment value they got. Plus, the way that you could update Jaws with the effects on the shark would be better, and Colin Trevorrow also is able to infuse the classic John Williams score that he had with Jurassic Park into the new one. You can do the same thing
I've never
with
seen
Jaws.
Dan seething on that couch.
I think if Joss Whedon can pull off the Avengers, he can definitely pull off a Jaws remake. I think he can have the fun of the original one. I think he can also bring in he'll use practical, he can be it'll be an epic blockbuster with a great ensemble and they'll all be superheroes. This is terrible. I don't know.
Yeah, but see,
Mark,
Joss Whedon's great at making like bigger huge mm-hmm. movies that have a lot of effects in them, but I think Colin Trevorrow is a little bit better at doing the small personal relationship, which is what Joss is.
Jurassic five. World is a giant distraction. I would say that Joss Whedon would get to the core of it. He can do small indie films like Much Ado About Nothing. He can get back to his core.
Wow. Well, Dan, I don't know about you. This has got to be really tough for you. I love the idea of making the effects better, right, with CGI. I'm sure you love that.
I didn't say with CGI.
My head exploded.
I didn't say with CGI.
But I got to say, based on the arguments, your main argument got a really messy. Superheroes.
I don't know. I just started
movie.
Throwing things out.
So,
I crapped the bed.
Whether
on this
I
one.
Agree or not, based on the argument, he did find something with Jurassic World. He made a lot of people did like it. It made a lot of money.
Who?
I'm giving Mark that point. It's almost the number one movie.
Mark Ellis liked Jurassic World, everybody.
I liked it the first time I saw it. So I'm giving my point to Mark. Mark Andreyko, quickly.
Are you his argument was shitty, but Jurassic World's one of the worst movies I've ever seen.
So
I would have gone with.
Okay,
Jaws.
So it's a tie. Dan, how fitting it comes to you.
Come on, Dan.
Favorite movies.
I have to defer to Mark. I cannot. I just have to be honest. I cannot be impartial about this. It's not possible for me.
We get
fair
one.
Enough.
So I'm going to let Meredith choose. I cannot be impartial about this.
Meredith, quickly, based on the arguments.
And don't base it on the creepy thing I said about Dorothy either. Don't hold that against me.
I'll not hold that against you.
I didn't
you.
Mean it.
I'm picking Ben.
Wow! Who's the
That's
judge
what you
on the show?
Too, Dan, right?
I would have. I mean,
well, all three of you would have. I was the only one who picked it.
But you're
I
the judge.
Go.
Why are we?
You're
why
the judge
cheering?
Of the show. I think we need to do a tiebreaker.
That's a tiebreaker.
What
a
movie by Booth. Come to democracy. Hey, in the booth, guys.
Crowd,
slow
quiet
the roll.
Down, crowd.
My head.
GT.
Who's the judge of the show? It's
so that Danny. Makes us a tie. It's not over, Ellis.
Not according to that scoreboard.
Guys, you're wrong, right?
I thought Andy gave the points on the
I
show.
I thought this was the deciding
God,
one.
God, this is a mess.
Oh, boy.
Oh,
why are we off on... Why is my scoreboard off from yours?
Because they heard you give me the point. And then you went to
the
peanut gallery.
That's correct, yes?
Sure.
Yes, guys?
Oh, man, I got to do better than last answer.
Dan?
It's correct by my score.
5-5-1 is what I had. Are we all correct in the board? Let's pay more attention,
okay,
guys.
I got
I've got it 5-5.
Two of you watching the show. One of you should be able to get it. All right, I have 5-5. That makes a tiebreaker because Mark was in the lead and Ben just got it, so that makes
somehow.
Sense to me.
Yes,
here's
Andy
our tiebreaker.
Shy.
Here is our tiebreaker. Keep that music rolling, people. Come on, here it comes. This is the ultimate. I was so close to getting this short. Jeez.
You're the judge.
Tiebreaker.
Uh-huh.
Can be a first or last name. Hollywood's best Smith.
Will Smith.
Is there a first name of Smith?
We just said it just in case. There's more Smith, last name Smiths we could think of.
I don't know any other Smiths.
I think that's the point then.
I just got killed.
Jada Pinkett Smith, sure.
Kevin Smith.
Sure.
Kevin Smith.
Oh, come on.
Mr. Smith from The Matrix.
Other, there was other ones. Wasn't I don't know.
Could
there
it have been a fictional character?
Maybe, yeah. I would have maybe accepted
could you take
it, but you didn't
Smith
pick it. All right, you pick Jada, you pick Will. Mark, on the board with Will. Go.
Because Will Smith has done it all. He's hit a little bit of a slide recently, but he's going to be back this December in Concussion, which could be an Oscar-winning role for him. The trailer that came out where he does an African accent and the way that he plays his true-life doctor, who is investigating concussions.
Okay.
Plus, he's the biggest box office star of the last two
decades. I think Jada Pinkett Smith has been living in Will Smith's shadow, and she's breaking out of it. I think in Gotham, when she played Fish Mooney, she had this villainous, awesome tour where she came back from, like, it felt like an old-school comic book villain, and I think that that could be the thing that launches her to an even bigger and better career than Will Smith.
I'm sorry, man. She's on a TV show, and she was Sherman Klump's date, but Will Smith was in some of the biggest box office successes
was.
Of all time, and he's going to be back in an Oscar-winning role this fall.
I would
fall.
Say
one second rebuttal.
I would cite After Earth. I would cite every other stinker. I would cite Focus. I would say that Jada Pinkett Smith can be on the upswing, whereas Will Smith is on the downswing.
Mark and Draco, quickly, please.
Will Smith was on a TV show, and Will Smith was in Made in America.
Doesn't
so.
Matter. What did he... Based on what they said...
Because
Ben didn't make that point.
Yeah, all right. So now there's rules. Now there's rules in the game.
There's always rules that I'm doing.
I'm not a fan, but he's got Suicide Squad coming up. I think he's going to be interesting. I'd have to give it to Will Smith.
Will Smith. Dan, can you be objective on this one?
Yeah, I can. I agree. It has to go to Will. I have to go Will.
I also agree. It was you got a little cocky, but you did.
I got
pull
a little
it off.
Cocky there, but
Will Smith.
Yeah.
It is. Mark Ellis gets the point, and that means Mark Ellis gets the win. Thank you. That time it's correct.
In defense, I had an impossible argument with Jada Pinkett Smith. I picked the
six.
And
you almost beat Will. Very exciting episode. Daddy guys, thank you so much for doing this. Thank you for watching. Got a little intense there. I love when it does. I want to thank each of you, but I want to thank you at home first and foremost. Don't forget secret, amazing, epic Screen Junkies news next week. So excited to finally reveal what we've been working on. I hope you love it. But I really want to thank you guys at home. I want to thank everybody here. Mark and Draco at Mark and Draco on Twitter. Anything you'd like to plug?
I'll be appearing somewhere else on some other show, I guess, from now on. I'm kidding. Boo-hoo for me. Wonder Woman 77 has been collected in two volumes. I'm doing the digital comic adventures of the
awesome.
Linda Carter
Woo-hoo!
Show set in the 70s. And there's going to be some other multimedia thing of mine announced soon.
Cool.
Not
come tell
cryptic,
us when it's ready.
But when I can, you guys will get the exclusive.
We're good at having secrets. I love it. Ben Bagley on Twitter.
Yep.
Thanks for coming.
Of course.
Great.
Thank
wow,
you
that close, man. For a newbie, that's impressive. Anything you'd like to plug?
Yeah, actually, my wife, Renee Dorian, and I, we wrote a horror comedy called The Funhouse Massacre, and it's coming out in select AMC theaters, 20 theaters nationwide. You can look it up in your local area or demand it if you want it to come
Sweet.
To you. It's a horror comedy with Robert Englund, Jerry Burns, Scotty Thompson, Clint Howard, myself, my wife, a whole slew of TV and up-and-coming people that is going to be—it's going to be the Wet Hot American Summer of horror films. Where in 10 years, you're going to be like, look at that, that guy was in it. It's a lot of fun. It's about these maniacs that break out of an asylum, and they descend upon a funhouse based on their crimes. And
that sounds awesome.
That should have been the Wes Anderson movie.
Yeah.
Check it out, everybody.
The Funhouse Massacre, and it's on Twitter at Funhouse Mass because there's a character limit, but, you know, go follow it.
Please go follow and please check it out. Thank you. Great job today. Mark Ellis. Jim. At Jim and the Holograms?
close, Andy. On Twitter, it's at 5150LC. Subscribe to my movie show, Schmoes Know, me and my buddy Christian. Thank you to all the loyal Screen Junkies fans. I'm also going to be in Austin, Texas, West Palm Beach, Florida, and Omaha. Upcoming stand-up dates. Get your tickets at markellislive.com.
Awesome, and please go subscribe to Schmoes Know. We love them, and they do fantastic programming if you don't already watch it.
Thank you, buddy.
On the Dan Cam, it's Mr. Merle Dan on Twitter.
At Merle Dan, I am so excited for the announcement next week. Having said that, I won't be here.
That's
so
right.
I hope
Sadly.
Everyone enjoys it.
But you are excited. We can get it on the record.
I'm super excited.
Now.
This is going
to
be
huge.
He
had to travel, but big news. Meredith, how did you feel? How did you like this? Was this fun for you?
Oh, man. This was so much fun. Geeked the entire time, and this is great.
Well, thank you for coming. And yes.
Quick thing I want to say. Hi to my friends, Emily, Brooks, Tully, and my sister, Emma. Thanks for watching.
Hi, guys. Thanks for watching. And thank you, Meredith, for watching and supporting us. I'm so happy to have you there. And please follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Andy Signor. Tell us what you want. And I'm so excited. Next week's big one. Actually, next several weeks are going to be big ones. Get excited. Cool. Thank you guys so much. And have an awesome Sunday.
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.